Good morning and welcome to Central Parish Pastoral Church this first Sunday in August. My name is Steve Stead and it is my pleasure to welcome you here as we worship together, as we celebrate the hope of Christ, as we rejoice in his resurrection, and as we proclaim the forgiveness offered through him. We gather today to worship, to praise. We gather together knowing that even though we are apart, we are together through the wonder of technology. May God bless you this day. May he speak to you, and may you continue to share the good news of Christ, mindful that you are the church and you are called to serve him. Our call to worship is found in the book of the Psalms, reading portions of Psalm 9. I will praise you, O Lord, with all of my heart. I will tell of all your wonders. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. Those who know your name will trust in you. For you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek after you. Let's turn our hearts to God as we prepare to worship this morning. Let's pray together. Wondrous God, we thank you that you have never forgotten us, that the promise of your presence and the gift of your hope found in Jesus Christ sustains us, strengthens us, and lifts us up. As we gather this morning hour to worship and to praise, to hear your word shared, to ponder the ways in which we can minister mightily in your name, to think of the ways that we can touch the lives of those around us. We ask that you give to us clarity of thought and purpose, that you quiet the busyness of our lives so that we can take time to reflect upon you, to reflect upon your word, to celebrate the gift of your Son. Be with us in this time of worship. May it fill our souls to overflowing. And may we be mindful that we are blessed to be called your sons and daughters. Sustain us now through the name of Christ, we ask it. Amen. We're going to begin our service this morning. We're going to be singing the song of praise entitled, Will You Come and Follow Me? Let us sing together.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Will you let my
We'll now share this time together. We come and hear God's word as it is broken for us. And our scripture lesson this morning is taken from Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19, reading verses 1 through 10. It is the story of Zacchaeus. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was the chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down. Come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost." Amen, and may the word of God speak to our hearts and minds this day as we ponder his word for us and how it speaks to us and how it guides us today. This morning we're going to continue our sermon series on Sesame Street and Scriptures. In the last couple of weeks we've looked at two characters of Sesame Street that are fairly well known, although one is clearly more popular than the other. We talked about the Count and about Oscar. This week, we're going to be looking at a couple of characters who surprised me that people remembered them and people remembered them so fondly, as they weren't seen on Sesame Street a great deal. In fact, over the 50 plus years of Sesame Street, they actually only appeared in 22 skits or 22 storylines. And out of those 22, 13 of them were focused on them alone. And yet, when I asked the question about who people find the most popular Muppet or character on Sesame Street, these two were mentioned by more than just one or two people. It amazed me. And yet, when I went back to look at clips on YouTube, I immediately was transported to my own childhood, because I remember these two growing up. And I remember how excited I was when they would appear on television. Perhaps because they weren't on it a lot, but also because I loved how they never gave up. I love how they continued to strive after their goals. And that was to communicate with what they came in contact with. Now you may be wondering who they are, and so I'll tell you. The Yip Yips. And you're probably scratching your head saying, "What? The Yip Yips?" And as soon as I show you the clip here in a minute, you'll immediately recognize them. They are the two aliens, or Martians, who basically come down. They look almost like octopus. They have the tentacles for legs, and they say, "Yip, yip, 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 yip." Or, "Nope. Nope, nope, uh-huh." And they're always trying to communicate with the items around them. Didn't matter that the objects were inanimate, that they weren't going to respond to them. They still tried to reach out to a grandfather clock, a computer. Occasionally, they would interact with some of the other characters in Sesame Street. But by and large, it was them trying to communicate using their earth book to these objects. This morning, we're going to look at the very first time they appeared on Sesame Street in 1972. And here we have the aliens who actually have names. Their names are Bob and Joe, talking or trying to talk to or communicate with a telephone.
Not Mars.
Nope.
Earth.
Yep.
Huh? Look. Hello.
Greetings. Greetings.
Hello. Hi there.
Nope.
Book.
Earth book.
Earth book.
Yep.
Cow.
Cow.
Yep. Cow.
Cat.
Cat.
Meow.
Nope.
Book.
Got book. Chicken.
Yep.
Yep.
What I love about that clip with the yip yips is how they never gave up trying to communicate with the phone. They were always trying to reach out. They tried talking to it as a cat, as a cow, as a chicken. They never stopped. And that's what really spoke to me when I was thinking about the yip yips and I was thinking about this portion of scripture that we shared. It was the question, how far would you go? How far would you go for something? The yip yips went a great deal. They tried a lot to reach out to, in this case, the telephone. Now we laugh because we know that the telephone isn't going to respond to them. And yet, we are called to reach out as well. In the very same way the yip yips were reaching out, we are called as Christians to be reaching out. And we have to be asking ourselves, how far will we go for the gospel of Jesus Christ? How far will we go to find Christ to serve Christ, to share Christ. This morning in our portion of scripture from Luke chapter 19, we see the character of Zacchaeus. Now, right now, I can almost guarantee some of you are at home singing the song you probably learned in Sunday school. Zacchaeus was a wee little man. A wee little man was he. He climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. There was no way I was going to sing that, but I know you are probably humming it at home. This is a portion of scripture about Zacchaeus, and that's how we look at this portion of scripture. We are introduced to Zacchaeus as a chief tax collector. And just to hammer home the point, Luke reminds us that he is wealthy. Tax collectors in the day were very wealthy indeed. They were wealthy because what they were doing was taking extra from the people, and they were skimming it off the top. If the Romans wanted them to collect 5% in taxes, they would collect 10%, and they would take the extra. It meant that they weren't very popular. Zacchaeus wasn't popular because he was working for the Romans. He wasn't very popular because he was taking money that really didn't belong to him. It shouldn't be any wonder to us that in and throughout the New Testament, we hear the phrase sinners and tax collectors almost hand in hand, as if they were the same thing. Because in the eyes of most people, they were. Sinners and tax collectors. Zacchaeus was not a popular man. But even Zacchaeus had heard about Jesus. If we were to go back into the end of Luke chapter 18, we'll see that as Jesus was approaching Jericho, a blind beggar received his sight. So word that Jesus was coming, word of Jesus of what he was doing, would have gone before him as he made his way into Jericho. And scripture tells us that even Zacchaeus, this man who was well off, this man who seemingly had everything, wanted to see Jesus. Now it's interesting because as the song says, and as we often think, we have the sense that Zacchaeus simply wanted to see Jesus. He wanted to look at Jesus. But scripture tells us it was something more than that. In verse 3 it says, he wanted to see who Jesus was. It wasn't that he simply wanted to see Jesus. He wanted to see who he was, what made him tick, what made him unique. What made him stand out? What made him the person people were willing to give up everything for to follow? You couldn't have two more opposite people in terms of their outlook on life as Jesus and Zacchaeus. And Zacchaeus had to figure out what was going on. He had to figure out how could people be attracted to this man who in the eyes of the world had nothing. And as we know, he wanted to see Jesus. He wanted to see who he was. But Zacchaeus was short, scripture tells us. He was short and he couldn't see. Again, it shouldn't surprise us any that the crowd wasn't going to do him any favors. After all, this was the guy who was taking their hard-earned money as a cut. So if Zacchaeus was behind them asking, excuse me, no one was going to move to get out of his way, to allow him to come to the front, to allow him to see Jesus. Not a chance. Even though they could probably see over him, they weren't going to do him any favors. So Zacchaeus was stuck. Zacchaeus wanted to see this Jesus fellow, to see what he was about, and yet no one was going to help him. Now Zacchaeus could have given up at this point. Zacchaeus could have thrown his hands in the air and said, well, I tried. I'm just going back to work. Back to my life, back to my wealth. He could have said, I'm going to make these people pay for not getting out of my way. There were a lot of things Zacchaeus could have done. Most of them would have involved him giving up. But Luke tells us he didn't do that. Luke tells us he did the exact opposite. He wasn't going to give up. This might be his one and only time to see this man called Jesus, to see this prophet, to see this Messiah, to see for himself who Jesus was. And nothing was going to stop him. How far would you go to encounter Christ? How far would you go to see Jesus? Zacchaeus climbed a sycamore fig tree. Now, I'm sure this would have caused a bit of a disturbance to see this well-off gentleman begin to climb up the tree, up into the branches, so that he could see above the crowd, so that he could watch Jesus coming, so that he could hear what Jesus was saying. He didn't care how silly it made him look. He didn't care how undignified he might have appeared. Because at the end of the day, what mattered was that he was going to see and hear and experience Jesus. That's the kind of passion we need to have as followers of Christ. That's the kind of passion we need to have to not give up, to go that extra mile. So that we can be transformed and in turn transform the world around us. The Yip Yips didn't stop trying to communicate with the phone. They mooed, they clucked, they meowed, trying to get the phone to respond. Zacchaeus probably didn't think Jesus would talk with him. Perhaps he thought Jesus wouldn't even notice him. But he was going to make the effort to see and to hear. And as Jesus was walking by, he looks up in the tree, because clearly you would notice somebody up in a tree branch, especially an adult. Jesus catches glimpse of Zacchaeus and says, Zacchaeus, come down now. Because I need to stay at your house today. I must stay at your house today. There was a sense of urgency in Jesus' voice. This was something no one expected. And of all the people Jesus could have spent time with in Jericho, Zacchaeus would not have been high on the list. And that's important for us to remember. It's very important for us to remember as followers of Christ. And the reason for that is this. The message today is called, How Far Would You Go? And a lot of times in this portion of scripture, talking about Zacchaeus, we talk about how far Zacchaeus would go to encounter Christ. And yes, it's important for us to remember, we need to make that effort to encounter Christ. We need to go that extra mile. We need to be willing to put ourselves out there. But, and this is so important, Jesus went that extra mile for Zacchaeus as well. Jesus could have gone anywhere in Jericho. Jesus could have done many things in Jericho. But Jesus said to this unpopular, unloved tax collector, I need to go to your house today. And let's just say the crowd wasn't thrilled. Verse 7 says, all the people saw this and began to mutter. Notice it doesn't say some of the people or a few of the people. It doesn't say the Pharisees and the scribes. It says all of the people. I wonder if that means his disciples and his followers as well. It very well could. And it serves as an important message to us. That Jesus will go to great lengths to bring people back home. Jesus will go to great lengths to show them that they are loved and they are forgiven. For some of you watching today, you need to hear that. You need to hear that Jesus will go to great lengths to remind you that you are loved and you are forgiven. No matter what you might be struggling with today, no matter what situations or circumstances that may be resting or laying heavily upon your lives, you are loved and you can be forgiven. Jesus is not giving up on you because you are his child. He didn't give up on Zacchaeus. He's not going to give up on you. Even when you may be giving up on you, Jesus is reminding you that he loves you, that he cares for you, and that he forgives you. The crowd was shocked. This isn't where Jesus should be going. This isn't who Jesus should be talking to. And yet it really shouldn't be a surprise, because throughout his ministry we see that Jesus, one of the complaints against Jesus was that he dined with sinners and tax collectors. He hung out with them. He ministered to them. And so it shouldn't surprise us at all that it was Zacchaeus. It was his house that he went to. But it didn't sit well. And as the church, we need to understand that Christ's love, that Christ's forgiveness is not limited to who we decide receives it or can receive it. You and I have experienced that love, have experienced that forgiveness. And so we should want that love and that forgiveness extended and shared with as many people as possible. And yet, there are times where we, like the crowd in this portion of Scripture, don't want it given to certain people or certain individuals because of what they have done. Because of how they have hurt us. Because how we say, well, they haven't learned. Well, we have to understand is that we are called to forgive because we have first been forgiven. We are called to love because we have first been loved by God. And that means we walk with one another. It is we, not us and them. We hinder the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we weaken the cross and the forgiveness found there when we make the determination who can receive it and who can't. In this portion of Scripture, Jesus is revealing to his disciples, to the crowd, to all around him, and to each one of us that forgiveness is not just for a select few. Forgiveness is offered to all. God's love is offered to all. And it's up to us to share it and to receive it. How far would Jesus go? Well, we see in this portion of Scripture. He went to Zacchaeus' house, and Zacchaeus was transformed. You cannot encounter Christ without being truly transformed. And Zacchaeus said to Jesus and to everyone who was around him, saying, "Here and now I'm giving half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody," and I really don't think there was any question on that, "I will pay them back four times the amount." For Zacchaeus, it simply wasn't the fact that he encountered Christ, but that he was transformed by Christ. He was transformed by Jesus coming to his house. He was shown how far Jesus would go for him. And now this is how far he was going to go for Jesus. He was showing the world the transformative power of Jesus Christ. And you and I are called to share and show that same transformative power by reaching out, by going the extra mile, by drawing people to Christ, by drawing people to the cross, and by showing people what it means to be loved and forgiven. None of this would have happened if Jesus didn't go that extra mile. None of us would be called brothers and sisters in Christ. None of us would be part of the church if Jesus didn't go that extra mile to the cross. So the challenge for you and I, the challenge that we as the church have, is to ask ourselves the question, how far will we go? And perhaps more precisely, will we go as far as Jesus does? To share that hope, that forgiveness, and that love. Let's now turn to God. Let's pray together. Wondrous, glorious, ever-loving God, we thank you that we might come into your presence, that we might be touched by your amazing grace. For we know that before time existed, you were there. Before the world came into being, you just were. Long after this creation fades away, you will continue to be. Humanity is such a small part of all that is, yet we fool ourselves into believing that we are invincible, that we are greater than we can imagine. You know our weaknesses. You know our propensity for destruction. You know how we wage war against our enemies, against our neighbors, and even against ourselves. Because we are lost. Because we are afraid. Because we make lines in the sand saying us and them. We long for you to come to us just as you did to Zacchaeus. We want you to stop in front of us and tell us that you are coming to our home. To know that you notice us. To know that you love us. Gracious God, we know that your steadfast love endures forever. We know that you walk with your people down life's road, through the good and the bad, through the ups and the downs. You remain steadfast and sure because you know who we are. Help us to remember whose we are. All too often our lives are cluttered with things that are unimportant, things that make it harder for us to recall or even experience anew the wonder and awe of your presence and your power in our lives. Help us to remember, O God, that you are a God who is slow to anger and who abounds in steadfast love. You are present in all the broken places in our lives and throughout the world. You wait for us to turn to you for healing, for justice, and for peace. Stir us into action, action that will set us on a path of service to you. Give to us the courage to ask the question, how far will we go? How far will we go for you? How far will we go for our brothers and sisters? How far will we go? So that the hope of Christ might be shown and shared. Loving God, we come We come before you today, knowing that we might be like Zacchaeus, struggling, wanting to see you, wanting to experience you, and unsure of what to do. Lord, speak to those people today. Let them hear what they need to hear. Let them see what they need to see. Let them know that you are with them in their struggles and in their uncertainties. We also know that there are some who gather who are like the crowd, who are struggling to let people in, who are struggling to share that good news, who are struggling to extend the cross to those who may have hurt them, who may have wronged them. Meet them in their struggle. Walk with them in their journey. Let them know that you are there. Let them know that they can pour out their frustration, their anguish upon you and you alone. Help us as the church to reach out to those who are hurting, those who are in pain, those who need to be reminded that they are loved. We think of those who have suffered loss this past week. We think of the family of the late Wayne Chatterton and the family of the late Heather Marr. May you comfort these families in the midst of their grief. May you speak to them words of comfort. May you remind them of the promise of your peace, which passes all understanding. May you be their hope in this time of loss. We're also mindful of those who are struggling with illness and sickness. And we pray, O God, for your hand to be upon Neil and Arthur, that you will lift them up and surround them with your grace, that the prayers of your people will be an encouragement to them, and that they will be encouraged and renewed. Be with us as we go from here today. Strengthen our steps and our path as we seek to follow you. For we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to close our service this morning by singing the hymn of praise, The Lord of the Dance. We'll worship God together.
Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. I'll lead you on wherever you may be. I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun, and I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all. Wherever you may be, I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced for the scribe and the Pharisee, but they would not dance, they wouldn't follow me. I danced for the fishermen, for James and John. They came with me, and the dance went on. Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all. Wherever you may be, I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on the Sabbath, and I cured the lame. The holy people said it was a shame. They whipped and they stripped and they hung me high, and they left me there on a cross to die. Dance, dance, wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all. Wherever you may be, I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on a Friday when the sky turned black. It's hard to dance with the devil on your back. They buried my body and they thought I'd gone, but I am the dance and I still go on. Dance, dance, wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all. Wherever you may be, I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. They cut me down and I leap up high. I am the life that'll never, never die. I live in you and you live in me, for I am the Lord of the dance, said he. Dance, dance, wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all. Wherever you may be, I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. Dance, dance, wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all. Wherever you may be, I will lead you all in the dance, said he. Dance, dance, wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all. Wherever you may be, I will lead you all in the dance, said he.
As we go now into the world, may we be asking ourselves the question, how far would we go? How far will we go to serve Christ? How far will we go to serve his church? How far will we go to show his love and forgiveness? May we not give up. And may we be encouraged, knowing that the grace, peace, and love of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is with us not only today, but in the days to come as we proclaim the hope of Christ. Amen.